In recent years, there has been a lot of negative media attention on the SAPS. From the shooting down of 44 miners in Marikana on the 16th of August in 2012, to the death of Andries Tatani, in which the policemen involved were not found guilty. In Soweto, residents were on a rampage by looting some of the foreign-owned spaza shops, and we noticed some shameful acts where the police were seemingly taking part, or rather not showing any initiative in coping with the situation. The figure for contingent liabilities constitutes 32.8% of the SAPS annual budget. The bulk of this figure is made up of civil claims against the police amounting to 14.8 billion rand. This figure quadrupled in the last 7 to 8 years, from 5.3 billion rand in 2006 to 20.5 billion rand for 2013-2014. This is according to statistics from Africa Check report. Most of the claims range from death at the hands of the SAPS members, rape, armed robbery, and misconduct cases. This leads us to one simple question: how do we restore our faith in the SAPS?
Well, that's the challenge that we're giving you this morning right here on Sunrise. As mentioned, a report released by the South African Institute for Race Relations and AfriForum on the state of the South African policing service suggests low levels of confidence in the police service due to a vast number of corruption cases and community servicing concerns. Data gathering for this report involved the scanning of media reports to identify incidents of police involvement in serious or violent crimes. This Hope Day Wednesday, we'll look at how communities can assist in restoring faith in the police system. And of course, joining us for this discussion is AfriForum Head of Communications Ian Cameron and SAPS Gauteng Provincial Commissioner Lieutenant General Leseja Mutiba. You at home can be part of our conversation by giving us a call on 011-537-9337 or 9338. We're also on Facebook and our Twitter pages. Good morning, gentlemen. Thanks for joining us this morning. I think, Ian, let's kick off with you in partnership with the SARRR. For this report, obviously you looked at these stories which were in the media. Some of them today, there's a big one in the front page of the Star as we speak. But the question is, what was the objective and what were the learnings from your previous report versus this one?
Unfortunately, a lot of the policy suggestions that we make, or fortunately, are the same ones that we made in the previous report. We wanted to make suggestions as to what we can better in the South African Police Service and what we feel from our side, from the private sector and from civil rights organizations, to how we can improve the South African Police Service. It's also important for us to show communities what is going on, because, and the only reason we did it is because communities came to us and they said, but we hear all these stories, do we have a reason to worry?
And what were the findings in terms of like in the report versus what in correlation to what was on the ground with the communities?
I must just make it clear, there was no purpose for us to draw quantitative conclusions from the report, yet we could see it was so easy to get all different cases. We had about between 300 and 400 cases, so let's say 350 cases. We drew a random 100 from them, and it was so easy to get them. Within 3 days we had all these cases, and they were all confirmed cases. Now, many of them came from IPED reports, they came from police reports, and then also from the media, and that's how we compiled it.
Okay, General Litton, let's just bring you into this conversation. In terms of you know, these challenges that SAPS is facing, the report clearly, you know, SAPS has come through and said we don't agree with some of these findings. What is the way forward in terms of like learning from what is out there and what you guys are faced with on daily basis?
The first thing, the report is not mentioning anything new to us. We have been on record to say that we know there's criminality in the South African Police Service. We're arresting our members, we're dismissing them, some of them are in jail. So the report is not telling us anything new. But what we want to object is the way in which the data was collected, because this is not a scientific report. This is not a report which is having qualitative value. But of particular importance is, if a person look at the architects of the Constitution of South Africa, they wanted to see a police-directed, a police-involved community. And here where I'm sitting, I want to say that We want our communities to work with the police. When we talk about that, we look at three broad areas. The first one is community involvement. When communities, as individuals, that they must look after themselves. They must prevent primary victimization. I must look after my property. The first one is the second one is community partnership. One communities, as in groups, in the police community, police forum, with the AFRI forum, we're engaging AFRI forum. AFRI forum is a very, very important stakeholder in crime fighting and crime combating. The last area is community mobilization. We must, as the police, as communities, engage one another in joint problem identification and joint problem solution.
Okay. All right. Let's take Tepo on the line from Midrandlands. Tepo, your comment or question this morning?
Yes, Penny. How are you?
We're good, thanks. Go ahead.
Penny, how are you, Penny?
I'm fine, thanks. Go ahead.
Yes, Penny, we've got faith in our SBS. The only problem is this. Police are doing their job. Only few of them are those who are doing the SAPS. It seems like it's corrupt. But I'm so very happy, even to our government, that are taking their very, very great step to those who are committing crime wearing the SAPS uniform. As we saw last week during the rampage with the foreigners, those who were people who were looking at people who were looting for the foreigners, there were those who are used to bribe. Those who were doing that job, they never let anything like that happen in the face of the public. Because everything that happened, it was in the face of everybody in the national television. But the police are doing their job as much as now things are calm, because it never went so long. Because it could have went so long in some other countries. It could have taken even some months.
All right.
I'm very grateful to Mr. Desijani there by doing their job, and I'm grateful to them. Pick up to them.
All right. Thanks for the call. Let's take Bongani out in Mpumalanga. Bongani, your comment or question?
Yes, and you know, faith in police we don't have, because you know, especially if you can look, especially that the picture that you were showing in now up Andristatan. Even if maybe I cannot say about it, even here in our community, if now I go to the police station, then I report my case, you will find that the police is a friend or is a family to anyone, or they know each other. Then you know, you go there, they just ignore you. You know, most of we just don't have faith. We sometimes we decide to take our own action instead of going to the police. So I believe that government must do something about it, because you know, if the police they beat a person like Andristatan in such a way, and after that nothing is happening, the police are not guilty, but the way they beat him that brutally they did, then unacceptable.
Okay, Bongani, thanks for the call there, talking about police brutality. Lieutenant, let's bring it back to you there, and sort of like, how does SAPS try and change these kind of perceptions that are out there in communities? You know, there's those who say, we have confidence, we believe. And there's those who say, you know, I'm fearful, I don't have confidence, I've lost total trust in SAPS.
I think that we must move from the generalization. If a person look at what happened in Soweto with the looting, I saw large-scale community involvement in working with the police. There are areas where we could not have contained that situation without the involvement of the community. I was in Deep Kloof Zone 5, where I found the locals protecting the shop of a foreigner. When we talk about community policy, the community cannot sit on the sideline and criticize the police, because in terms of the Police Act, communities are part of policy. And we do have our fair share of rotten apples.
Mm.
And we talk about that. The National Commissioner is on record that judge us in terms of how do we deal with these corrupt members. Okay. And we do deal with them.
Now, Ian, before we take our Facebook comments, I would like your response, and also talk about, you know, if in the report we do have recommendations on talking on strengthening and sort of the functioning of like an involvement of communities. Was that looked at? Because these were reports were in the newspaper, which means our stories are out there. But are these, do we have stories coming from the bottom up rather than what is already, you know, in the public eye?
I think firstly we need to say the one thing that we believe should change is that we need to start seeing convictions in the police. I went and drew some statistics from IPED reports, and you know, in the past few years they've had 900, just over 9,000 cases. Mm. Sorry, 9,000. Only 5,000 were completed. Only 1,470 were referred to the National Prosecuting Authority, mm. and it only ended up with 83 convictions. Now, 83 out of 5,000 cases that were handled isn't what we want to see. Now, I take my hat off to the police because they are leading the way in getting rid of the criminal element, but the problem is they're being dismissed, they're not being convicted. We need criminal convictions, because otherwise we had a criminal in a uniform, mm-hmm. now we just have a criminal without a uniform, mm. and that's the change we need to see. Then onto the community part, from AfriForum's side, I couldn't agree more with the general. We have to make sure that communities are involved. I think it plays a massive role, and it's the only way at the moment, especially, unfortunately, we do have a lot of rotten apples in the police, and we can see that on local levels, and the way we see it changing is when we start working with the police and we can start pointing things out and it can be handled on senior levels.
All right, okay.
Can I respond to that?
Okay, go ahead.
The most important thing is, in terms of our code of conduct, we deal with the members that transgress our code of conduct and we dismiss them. But when it comes to the broad criminal justice system, we arrest a member. And when he goes to court, we're not having any control over that. And we must know some of the members that are being found not guilty, mm. They must be respected, because no one must be found guilty in the opinion of people. We all of us respect the court of the country.
So do you bring those people back into the system, or that if they dismiss and they, you know, committed a crime and you never bring them back?
Remember that we are having our own code of conduct. So someone might not be found guilty in a court of law, but in terms of our code of conduct, if we say we don't want the murderer, but and then the person is out of the police service.
I must also respond that last year the Minister General, he admitted that there are just over 1,400 police officers in uniform, mm. that have criminal records, and 80% of those were serious and violent crimes.
So is the challenge, in the process of investigation, making sure that these cases hold when it goes to court, or is the challenge that, I mean, someone will argue that these are the police investigating themselves, how can we expect, something to come out of this?
Our investigation service is very much good, it's very much qualitative. Of particular importance is the fact that many of the cases that is being mentioned are very, very old cases. Some of them come from the 1970s.
Yes. In 2015?
Yes, and some of them come from 1980s. The code of conduct that we are now having, and the National Commissioner that we are now having, have declared zero tolerance on police criminality, but on police misconduct as well. So many of these cases are very, very old cases, and the code of conduct was not there.
Okay, General, I think what we're trying to say is I would like to see these numbers of conviction changing. But let's find out what's going on Facebook with some of our viewers in terms of their comments and views about this conversation. Faith is standing by with that.
Well, thank you very much, Penny. Yes, indeed, the very simple question we asked on Facebook is, do you have faith in the South African Police Service? And these are the various comments to have come out this morning. So let's start off with Mervin saying, don't blame the police, blame the government. DJ is saying, police of today, they are legal criminals. Mabunda, I'm afraid of the police more than I'm afraid of criminals. Dennis saying, the faith and trust in our police is generally low, but there are those dedicated cops out there who understand the responsibility they have towards the betterment of the country. The problem is our government with all these corrupt leaders, incompetence, etc. Sabela saying we can still give them the benefit of the doubt, 60%, but our justice system is simply messed up. Mazo saying no more needs to be done to train them and how to treat the general public, teach them English, how to read and write, and they don't follow up on cases. Prey is saying, no, I don't have any faith. Police stations are 4 kilometers away, but when you call, they come after 3 hours while they're busy running around with their vans. Nkosikwana saying, not until Begicele comes back to his office. And a very interesting sort of posting there by Halden saying, murder, theft, rape, kidnapping and assault are wrong until I put on my magic suit. So you can see that comment there, quite strong sentiments shared about the police service, various comments coming out there about some of the issues within the SAPS, but I'll leave it to your guests to further divulge into the matter.
Thanks very much to Faith. The interesting comments coming out from our viewers, gentlemen. I think from your side, Ian, what I'd like to find out for you to think about is solutions that we can learn from this experience. But, General, in terms of you,
First of all, the police themselves need to have confidence in themselves, and for us to be able to have confidence in them in, as communities. And as you correctly says, communities, you like communities to work closely with them. But how do we match that relationship and get to a place where we're moving forward?
What I like about especially the Police Act of 1995, it is making provision for communities to be actively involved. There are those communities that are they don't even know their rights in terms of policy. We are having a lot of structures where if you are not happy with police service, that you can go to. You can go to the National Commissioner, you can go to the Provincial Commissioner, you can even go to the AFRI Forum, you can go to the Community Police Forums. These avenues must be exhausted. Of particular importance is communities must know and have a partnership with their local police. When there's a problem, we're having our station commanders, we're having our community police forums chairpersons. Some of the complaints against the police are because many of our communities don't know how our system works. There are complaints where when we investigate, we found that our members were right. But where our members are found to have transgressed, we do activate our disciplinary processes.
Ian, the role and responsibilities of, like, you know, civil service organizations like yourself and community individuals and communities, do we even understand what our rights are and how we can further, you know, achieve the service that we'd like to get out of SAPS?
Definitely. I think when you have groups like AfriForum or the Institute for Race Relations and different organizations that play a civil role, we can put a lot of pressure on there, and it's also a large-based group. So altogether, it makes the voice so much stronger. So we encourage individuals to get involved with these kind of things because it makes their voice stronger. And I think that's one way we can pressure it. One thing that we see as a solution that we need to change, that we would really like to see the National Commissioner being a career police officer. We need someone who's got years of experience. Now, I was challenged on that by the police, saying that, but who else was a career police officer? That's not the question. That's exactly why we have these problems, or it's one of the reasons. We need to see a career police officer that can start structuring and restore the chain of command in the SAPS.
Okay, let's we went to the streets to also find out what people think on the streets. Let's hear what they got to say.
The reason is that the reason I'd say we trust our police system is because I've seen them help us a lot, you know, most times. It happens that most of the times that we can't trust them, it's only when they're really under pressure.
A whole lot of crime happening everywhere, and I don't see anything being done about it. The whole process as to how policemen actually become policemen or women should be changed, because I feel like, you know, it's an easy field to get into, so everybody goes into that field without the mentality or the heart to actually be wanting to do the job correctly. You know, it's not what they really want to do, so I feel like the whole system to attaining a degree or a diploma or whatever it is to become a police woman or man should be changed. I think that's where the problem lies, honestly.
At some point, I feel like we cannot trust them, because now we're being robbed every day and night, and there's a kid
in some situations they can't.
All right, those are the comments from the street. Just lastly from the both of you, General, how do we move from there to getting the communities to have trust in SAPS?
The first thing, we want to make an appeal to our communities to work with the police, because nowhere in the world does it happen that the police fight crime on their own. Mm. We want to encourage the communities to be part of groups, the Community Police Forum, Business Against Crime, AFRI Forum, because it is only that when we are united, we can effectively deal with crime.
Okay, we've already, there were learning key points coming out of the report, and looking at that, what's the way forward?
I think on senior level, we need to stop political interference. At the moment, we can see that the ANC are using the police as a political chess field. And then we need to make sure that we have career officers in management. And from there, we can restore the chain of command.
All right, great stuff. Thanks, guys, for joining us this morning, chatting to AfriForum Head of Communications there, Ian Cameron, and, of course, joining us from the Gauteng SAPS, Provincial Commissioner, Lieutenant General Lesedi Motsiba, joining us for that conversation. SAAfriForum.co.za, that's their website. And, of course, for complaints, you can go to ipad.gov.za. That's for complaints for the police. Faith is standing by to make you a winner this morning. We're back after this.